Evening, everybody. The Institute of Politics is predicated on the notion that politics is a worthy pursuit, and that public service is an honorable way to devote one's life. And so it's an honor to bring Senator Jim Webb here tonight, because he's devoted so much of his life to service in Vietnam, combat service as a leader of the military later under the Reagan administration, service as a United States senator. And in all of those pursuits, the thing that I think would be said of him is that he always put the public interest ahead of party, and that he took public service seriously as a means of bettering our country, advancing America and its values. And so it is, it's a great honor to welcome here tonight. I'm not going to go through his full history, because we have a student, as we always do, here to introduce him, and I'm going to introduce that student if I can find my glasses. Brian Schwartz is a first year at the University of Chicago who hails from Eastern Long Island. He is a prospective chemistry and molecular engineering double major. Show off. When not working on his academics, he is the vice president and director of athletics for the Maroons Veterans Alliance, a new organization on the University of Chicago campus working to help veterans get the medical support and career advocacy needed to return into the workforce. With the MVA, he ran the first 3-on-3 basketball tournament that raised funds for the Intrepid Fallen Heroes Fund, and is planning a spring tennis tournament for the same charity. So all of you tennis players here, please see Brian after this program. Brian.
Thank you, Professor Axelrod. It is my pleasure and honor to introduce Senator Jim Webb here to the University of Chicago. So coming from a military family, Senator Webb would follow in his father's footsteps of entering the U.S. Armed Forces, becoming a part of the Marine Corps and Navy. Mr. Webb graduated from the Naval Academy in 1968, receiving a special commendation for his leadership contributions. He served as a rifle platoon and company commander in Vietnam. Mr. Webb served as counsel to the House Committee on Veterans Affairs from 1977 to 1981. In 1984, he was appointed Assistant Secretary of Defense for Reserve Affairs, the first person to hold this position, and in 1987 was appointed to the Secretary of the Navy. While in the Senate, Mr. Webb served on the Foreign Relations, Armed Services, Veterans Affairs, and the Joint Economic Committees. On his first day in office, he wrote and guided to passage the post-9/11 GI Bill, the most significant veterans legislation since World War II, and co-authored legislation which exposed $60 billion of waste, fraud, and abuse in Iraq and Afghanistan wartime support contracts. In addition to his public service, Mr. Webb has enjoyed a varied career as a journalist. He received an Emmy Award for his PBS coverage of the U.S. Marines in Beirut in 1983. Due to his heroism in the military, he was awarded the Navy Cross, the Silver Star Medal, 2 Bronze Star Medals, and 2 Purple Hearts. His citation for the Navy Cross says, "By his courage, aggressive leadership, and selfless devotion to duty, First Lieutenant Webb upheld the highest traditions of the Marine Corps and of the United States Naval Service." Thank you, Senator, for speaking at our event today. It is an honor to have you at the University of Chicago Institute of Politics. Please join me in giving a warm welcome to Senator Jim Webb. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Brian. I don't know what a molecular engineer does. I have to say, I'm a little in awe. When I went to the Naval Academy, we had a mandatory engineering program, which I kind of suffered through. And used to do things like carve in our desk, "Entropy is alive and living in Argentina." I was one of, I guess, 3 people in the United States Senate with an engineering degree. But trust me, you do not want me as your engineer. And David, thank you very much for this invitation, and it's an honor to be here with, with David, the service that he has given to our country and many different political leaders. He's made a mark that's made him one of the top, very top tier of political analysts and commentators in the country, and also for your leadership in establishing this Institute of Politics. I was a fellow at the Harvard Institute of Politics in 1992. I think this is a very similar program and not a great deal of enthusiasm when I was at the Harvard program. So I appreciate all of you coming tonight. We have, I guess, about 1 hour to the minute here. And I will warn you at the beginning, I just got off a plane from Bangkok 2 days ago, and my time zones are a little conflicted. I'll tell you a little bit more about the reason for that earlier, but I'll do my best to concentrate and answer your questions during the Q&A, and I look forward very much to the Q&A. I've spent just about half of my professional life in public service and half in the private sector as a sole proprietor and principally as a writer. It's a career that does not naturally align, but I believe it's really been useful in terms of looking at what's going on in our country from different perspectives than I would have been able to have if I had simply stayed in the political environment throughout my professional career. When I ran for the Senate, we focused on three main issues, and I think they're still the principal issues as we look forward to where the country needs to be fixed. The first was to address issues of economic fairness and social justice. And I was saying in 06 that we had a breaking apart in this country, not from the top to the bottom, and the John Edwards I know was running and was talking about the two Americas, but that we're moving into basically what could be called three Americas. We are a country that is rightly dedicated to helping people who have become unable to help themselves or who need a hand when times are bad. We've got a good safety net in this country, I think, for people who have fallen by the wayside and need some sort of government assistance. At the top, we've seen an elite move further and further away from the rest of the country, and this has only become worse over the past 7 or 8 years, not better. But we're seeing a lot of people start talking about this. I was very privileged to give the State of the Union response to President Bush's State of the Union address in 07, and people wanted me to talk about the war in Iraq, and I did, but the first thing I talked about was the need for us to reinvigorate opportunity for the entire country. We want everyone to be able to believe in the American dream. When I graduated from the Naval Academy, the average corporate executive in this country made 20 times what the average worker made. Today, that number is upwards of 300. It depends on how you calibrate it, but it's probably closer to 400 times what the average worker in this country makes. At the same time, the model of the American workforce is changing for our younger generation, just as the demographics are changing. With the loss of the manufacturing sector jobs that we've seen over the past 20 years and the evolution of service economies and contractual work, it's very difficult for younger people and a lot of people who are not younger people to have the type of occupation and work where they get health care benefits as a part of their employment, and they have retirement benefits as a part of their program. I mean, they can look forward to a career in a particular career field. These things are rapidly changing as our economy also changes. So we're looking at a situation in this country, even with the recuperation from the Great Recession, 08, 09, where if you have an education from a place like the University of Chicago, if you have capital assets, you're probably doing pretty well. For instance, if you look at the stock market, I don't know what the numbers are today, but when the stock market bottomed out in April of 09, it was just a little bit above 6,000. It's now almost tripled. In fact, it was above 18,000 last month. I don't know where it is at the exact moment. So if you have stocks, if you're able to participate in the capital side of our economy, you're probably doing pretty well. And if you don't, you're probably not doing very well. If you look at real wages, they have actually dropped since the 09 numbers started going up. Loans for small businesses have gone down as the economy writ large has gone up. These are challenges, and they're challenges for our leadership. The second issue that we focused on when I was running, when I was in the Senate, was the need for us to reorient our national security policy around the world. We really have not had a clear strategic doctrine since the end of the Cold War. I would say particularly since about 1993, but since the fall of the Berlin Wall, the demise of the Soviet Union. We have been playing ad hoc when it comes to our foreign policy. You can see this in the manner in which we address legitimate national security interests in the Middle East, but the way that we did them was not healthy for the region or for the national security of our country. I was the first person, I believe, to have warned about the war in Iraq, the consequences of the war in Iraq, 5 months before the invasion of Iraq. I wrote a piece in the Washington Post basically saying, if we invade Iraq, this is going to be a strategic blunder. It's going to empower not only Iran, but China. And if you can take a look at what's happened in East Asia since then, that is actually happening. And it's going to break the country apart in terms of sectarian violence. The other thing that I said in the piece was that there is no exit strategy because they don't intend to leave. We have suffered the consequences of that in terms of trillions of dollars of expenditures. Our position in the region from the invasion of Iraq and from other policies has destabilized a lot of the region. And again, in ecumenical fairness here, I have to say I believe the way in which this present administration handled the Arab Spring has had strong negative consequences for our position in the region. I was a vocal opponent of the manner in which the administration went into Libya. If you look at the action in Libya in historical terms, sure, Gaddafi was a bad guy. We understand that. But we had no treaties in place. We had no Americans at risk. We were not under any threat of attack. If you have a situation like that, you need to come to the United States Congress, if you're the president, before you use military force. The doctrine that was announced when we went into Libya was basically a humanitarian assistance doctrine, a humanitarian intervention doctrine, or in the military they call it R2P, responsibility to protect. And the way that that policy has been put into place, it means potentially that a president on his own initiative, without coming, or her initiative, without coming to the Congress, can decide to use military force anywhere. Under the broad terms of humanitarian intervention, you could decide that, how many Irish people with Irish ancestry are here? I may be treading something here, but I mean, if you have the IRA going at it with the Ulster Protestants, the president under this doctrine could decide, all right, we're going to put military forces in. It's a very dangerous doctrine. In terms of issues of terrorism and the Middle East, I think we are well behind where we could have been if we had taken different decisions in that part of the world. I have spent a great deal of my life working in and out of Asia, particularly Southeast Asia, as a journalist, as a military person, as a government official, as a writer, as a novelist. I've spent a good bit of time in that region. And I have to say, one of the things I'm proudest of during the time that we were in the Senate was that we began what became called the pivot to Asia when the Obama administration came into authority. We began that program, or the strengthening of our relationships in East Asia 2 years before President Obama was elected. I fought to get a seat on the Foreign Relations Committee. I brought people from my staff in and I said, we must, for our strategic, economic, cultural, and other interests, we must reinvigorate our relation with Japan, South Korea, Vietnam, Singapore, Thailand, and we must change the formula in what was then called Burma, which now I think we're finally using the term Myanmar. We worked very hard to create the new relationship in Myanmar, in Burma. I had visited Burma as a private citizen before I was elected. I had begun talking about the better approach in that country, reducing the sanctions, encouraging it to move toward democracy. I'd seen the model work in Vietnam after the end of the Vietnam War, after we had had sanctions against the Vietnamese government from 1975 to 1994, which, by the way, I supported for a very long time because of the conditions of the Arvin soldiers and families who had been with us and who were being maltreated by the communists. But we changed the formula in Vietnam. It has made a remarkable difference in the country. We're still waiting for democracy in Vietnam. We're still waiting for opposition parties. But removing the sanctions, getting people in to trade and to show how the outside world looks at different issues has had a major impact. We did the same thing in Burma. It took me 7 months from our office to negotiate a visit to Burma in 2009. And I became the first American leader to visit that country. We started opening up the relations, and the Burmese now are moving much, much more closely to an open democracy. They're not there yet, but they're certainly a long way away from where they were in 2009 when we began this process. We spent a lot of time talking about issues of social justice, like the criminal justice reform issue. If you look at the future of the country, these are the kinds of things that we're still going to focus on. I want to spend just a couple minutes talking about an issue facing our country, our leadership, and our political system that troubles me greatly, and I think that we need to find a better way forward on. And that is what a lot of people are calling the corruption of our political system due to the way that campaign finance has changed. I get around the country a lot, different, not only geographically, but I've got a lot of friends who do different things. And one thing I hear over and over again is how frustrated people in this country have become with the political leadership in both parties. We call it incumbent fatigue. They don't see the answers coming out of the political system right now. And if you look at the larger political system, before we look at leadership per se, you can see such a dramatic difference just since the Citizens United case in 2012. For those of you who aren't familiar with the Supreme Court case, it basically said in terms of First Amendment that you cannot stop any person, any corporation, any organization from spending as much money as they want to spend in order to exercise their First Amendment rights when it comes to political discussion. What we're seeing here is a classic confrontation between law and the First Amendment, both areas of which we hold sacrosanct in our country. The First Amendment says you can't stop me from expressing my views. The legal side says you can only spend so much money on a political campaign. I'll give you a good example. For our presidential exploratory committee right now, the maximum anybody can give is $2,700. But that same person can walk across the street, open up a super PAC or a 501c nonprofit and spend $200 million if they want, and there are people who are spending, you know, in the millions of dollars, and organizations, millions of dollars in a super PAC or a so-called nonprofit, and a lot of times we don't even know who these people are. I've read this case, the Citizens United case. I understand Justice Kennedy's rationale when he says that the First Amendment is sacrosanct. What they said in this case, though, was that is for independent expression. In other words, you're not supposed to be communicating with a candidate when you do this. If you communicate with the candidate, well, then it's 2700. But our political process has made a mockery of this decision. We're looking, you know, in terms of presidential runs, we're looking at the potential of people raising not just hundreds of millions of dollars, but close to $1 billion. Now, where's that money coming from? And what are the expectations when tons of money is coming in to support one candidate or another? And is this really independent expenditure separate from a candidate? We've seen Jeb Bush, not to pick on him, but he's been in the paper in the last week or so on this. He's got two super PACs. Since he's not officially a candidate, he's able to go sit down with this supposedly independent organization and discuss strategies with them. I wouldn't say that is what the Supreme Court intended when this legislation or when this decision came down. And how does that affect individuals who want to participate or are participating in the electoral process? Here's the reality. You know you got to raise a lot of money. And if you don't raise a lot of money, you're going to have a lot of stuff coming at you through the media and through other manners. You know, when I ran for the Senate, I had been involved in the political process as a commentator for many, many years, and as a defense executive and a committee counsel in the Congress, but I'd never run before. And it's an entirely different process when you actually run for a higher level position and start anticipating. You can say, all right, I'm a very bad fundraiser. Everybody here, I think, knows that. If you don't, I'll remind you. But you say, okay, I'm not going to go ask you for your money. You know, I'm independent. I have these views. And then somebody starts saying to you, well, you know what's going to happen about the second week of October? You know what you're going to see? You know how many of these things you're going to see coming at you? And that was before the Citizens United case. So I think what, at a minimum, what you're seeing in our political process is an intimidation of a lot of good people who would otherwise want to participate, who realize that they have to go out and raise this kind of money and potentially make the kind of compromises that makes it less of an incentive to come in and serve their country the way that they might. I have a good friend who will remain nameless, but he's a very, very successful business person. I know him from the Marine Corps. When I started talking to him 6 or 7 months ago about what it might take to run for the presidency, the very first thing he said to me was, I have never met anyone who was able to survive this whole process and come out on the other end able to speak his mind the way that he did before he entered it. There are just too many compromises that have to be made with the money that's in the process right now. I like to believe that that's not necessarily an absolute. I like to believe that with the right kind of help from the people who see where the problems are, you might be able to do it, not with the same kind of money, but truly, I think we are freezing out a lot of good minds and good leaders from the political process right now with the way that money has started dominating things that we do. And that being said, I think we're right about on schedule. I'll just start taking some questions. Yes. Oh, that's we're gonna go. You go ahead. I cut off the process, but since I called it, you go right ahead.
Thank you. Hi, Senator. Thank you so much for coming. You're one of my favorite politicians and authors simultaneously. I have a question for you. Should you run in 2016? I was thrilled to hear your announcement in November. a lot of the national discourse, especially in the Democratic Party, has to do with social issues. And while the issues that you've mentioned here are some of the most important to me, I think a lot of what dominates the conversation are things like women's issues and gay marriage. Your positions on which have been controversial in the Democratic Party, how do you plan to address those kinds of issues when and if you run?
Okay, thank you for the question. I've taken strong positions on a lot of issues over the years, but I think if you look at my voting record and otherwise in the Democratic Party at the time that I was in the Senate, I don't have any conflict with the Democratic Party at all on those issues. Here's my greater concern, and that is when I decided to run for the Senate as a Democrat, and by the way, there are people who said, "What are you? You work for Ronald Reagan. How can you run as a Democrat?" You know, and I said, "Let's not forget, Ronald Reagan was once a Democrat." And not only that, but the Democrats elected Ronald Reagan twice, the Reagan Democrats. But when I decided to run as a Democrat, the reason that I did was because the Democratic Party traditionally, from its founding, has been the party that addresses the issues of well-being and opportunity for everyone, to give the working people in the country a voice in the corridors of power that otherwise they would not have. And when you look at these issues like economic fairness and criminal justice reform, these are issues that cut across gender, they cut across race, and yet too often they have been characterized as excluding white working people. Particularly in the border south for a lot of different reasons. And one of the things that I've said again and again is that the Democratic Party needs to get back on message in terms of inclusiveness. We're a very complicated country demographically, even more complicated than we were when the civil rights movement did all those things 45 and 50 years ago. And we need to bring everyone forward so that people feel that they all have a shot. And the social issues that you mentioned are issues where I think there's been, unfortunately, a dividing line. If you look at the American South, look at the voting of working white people. And, you know, frankly, a lot of times even saying that phrase causes people to get nervous in our country anymore, and it should not. I remember when I'm gonna back up one second here when I said before I get into the election results. When I was running, we had a meeting of the candidates who were running in 06, the Senate candidates, up in Nantucket. It's the only time I've ever been to Nantucket. I will never go back to Nantucket. But we had this consultant group that came in, and they're talking about how do you run, you know, and they had this issue and that issue, and they said, okay, how do you get the white working male? And they had these support this, support this, support this. And I said, hey, you know, this isn't really that hard. They aren't aligning themselves with the Democratic Party because they don't think the Democratic Party wants them. And so on these social issues, rather than on their own economic well-being and the historical notion, you know, Harry Truman, Franklin Roosevelt, Andrew Jackson, this is where they should be. But instead, two-thirds of them vote Republican. You take a look at the poorest county in America, Clay County, Kentucky, in the Appalachian Mountains. My dad's family came out of the Appalachian Mountains. 94% white. 40% poverty. They vote two-thirds for Mitch McConnell when he runs for re-election. And they vote on these social issues. The social wars are, I'm not going to say they're over, but I think the country is now so much better off on these issues than it was years ago that this is a real opportunity for the Democratic Party to bring these people back in an inclusive way.
Senator, if you just want to grab a seat. I'm Matt Jaffe. I'm the
Sorry
IOP.
For jumping you.
No worries. I know there are a lot of questions tonight, so hopefully we'll get to as many of them as possible. I'm Matt Jaffe. I'm the IOP's Communications Director, and I know that there are a lot of questions out there, so we'll get back to the Q&A in just a second, and as always, we'll start with student questions. First, I just had a quick question for you. You are the first well-known Democrat to launch an exploratory committee. You're heading, I believe, to Iowa for 4 days later this week, South Carolina later this month. I think New Hampshire next month. So I think one of the questions on everybody's minds is, are you planning to run for president?
We're taking it a day at a time, and I think that's realistically the best way for us or other people who might be running. But actually, what going back to your question, you know, when I left the Senate, I decided I would take a year and do no interviews at all, no op-eds. I used to write a lot of op-eds for New York Times and Wall Street Journal, both, and kind of get my philosophical independence back, away from the caucus mentality and those sorts of things. And when I started getting out again last May, I just started getting a ton of emails and communications from people. I started on an NPR show, and you know, it's one of these, you know, how the media questions go. The question was, would you consider running for vice president? I said, no, you do not want me as your vice president. And they said, well, how about president? And I said, I don't know. What I know is this, that we are back in the discussion again. Actually, it had been a year and 4 months by then. We're back in the discussion. We're back in the debate. I know the issues that I care about. We're going to put them out there. And I just started getting a ton of emails. Some people saying, Republicans, independents, and what I would call the Truman Roosevelt Democrats. Just hundreds of emails coming in saying, please consider running. So, you know, we've been around talking to people, listening to people, which is the only way, you know, someone who has been out of office like I have, it's the only way to really test the water. So we're going into Iowa. I'm going to spend 4 days in Iowa starting tomorrow. And as you said, we're going to be in New Hampshire, and we'll just see.
One of the candidates who looks like she's set to jump into the race, of course, is Hillary Clinton. And recent polls have shown her up around 60%. But Al Hunt, a columnist for Bloomberg, recently wrote a story that said why Jim Webb could be Hillary Clinton's worst nightmare. Do you think, I won't ask you if you think you might be her worst nightmare, but do you think that Hillary Clinton is beatable in 2016?
I think early poll numbers can always be tricky. As I recall, I think in 92, Bill Clinton was at about 3% early in 92. So the poll numbers in and of themselves, they're almost more name identification at this point. But other than that, you know, I respect Hillary Clinton's service, served with her in the Senate. And, you know, I don't think I should be commenting on me running against her. She's, I think, you know, she's got a good record.
I want to ask you a quick question about your time in the Senate. You know, you were elected in 2006, and you beat George Allen in Virginia. In that race, you only jumped in, I believe it was 9 months before Election Day. You had very little money, very little staff, and I think a lot of people looked at early polls and kind of, you know, thought that they did not bode well for you. And of course, you ended up winning that race.
There may be a pattern here, by the way.
Yeah. you know, then you go on and you serve only one term in the Senate and you decide to leave. What was it about that term in the Senate, those 6 years in Washington on the Hill, that made you decide, I want to move on?
Well, I think people probably would understand that if they looked in the context of my professional career. 6 years is a term and a half of the presidency. It's not a short period of time. They say only one term. But I've spent four different periods in my life in public service. First in the Marine Corps, then as a committee counsel for 4 years in the House. Used to put 25 bills a year through the House floor. Then 5 years in the Pentagon, one as a Marine, and then four as a defense executive, and then in the Senate. And each time, I've taken a step back and done journalism, you know, done these other things. So it wasn't simply, you know, one term and I'm out. Mm-hmm. Now the election itself, we announced for the Senate 9 months to the day before the election, had no money, no campaign staff, but I did a lot of thinking beforehand. I mean, I like to, you know, I like to think and then act, not act and then think. And we were 33 points behind on a good day. And I went out, I had a contested primary And that was the first time I'd actually put myself before a vote of anyone. But it was a Democratic Party, established Democratic Party person who was able to self-fund. And went out three meetings a night, got in an old Jeep, drove from place to place, got one of my radio operators from Vietnam, this guy Mac McGarvey, who'd gotten his arm blown off, got a tattoo on the stump, said cut on dotted line. I asked a question in there, anybody here been to Nashville before? Nashville, Tennessee. Yeah, Mac was the night manager at Tootsie's Orchid Lounge in Nashville. And I said, Mac, I need somebody that I can trust 24 hours a day. He quit his job, moved into my basement for a year, and became our driver. And Mac and I, you know, we went out three meetings a night. You know, the first question I would get, this was a Democratic primary, first question I would get was, again, why should we vote for you when you work for Ronald Reagan? I already answered that. And then the second questions were usually about ideas and issues, the things we were talking about. We won the primary with a very strong vote. You could say we only won by 10,000, or you can say we came up from our 33-point deficit. I choose to say we came up from our 33-point deficit.
We will now start taking some more audience questions. So we'll start with students. So students, please raise your hands. We'll start right back there. Harry, right in the back, the gentleman in the blue shirt.
Hi, Senator. At the beginning of your speech, you talked about the ways in which the economy has fundamentally changed and what that means for the middle class and opportunity. Do you see that change as something that is fundamental and sort of something we must adapt to, or something that the government could work to correct?
I believe there are ways for us to address this issue. The first thing we need to remember is the most important facet of our economy is to keep growing it. You know, we need a strong economy. We are at a position now where I think even in the manufacturing sector, there are a number of companies who would want to come back here if the incentives were there. I mean, when you look at the cost of shipping and these sorts of things, particularly in Asia. The second thing I think we can look at is how the tax code protect a lot of the income that is received from, particularly from corporate executives and these sorts of things. Where you've got this, first of all, here's a quick model of something we could be looking at. We have a very high corporate income tax rate. But there are a lot of loopholes in there. And I think we could lower the corporate income tax rate, remove the loopholes, incentivize a lot of corporations that are holding money overseas to bring money back in and do a better job with the strength of our economy. Southside Virginia is a good example of what's happened countrywide. You know, Southside Virginia used to have a large manufacturing sector. Furniture, textiles, those sorts of things. It's all gone. It's all gone. And the workforce down there doesn't have the types of jobs that will hold them even in that part of Virginia. But you can do that. And then on the individual side, we've got this, I think, odd situation. Remember when I was talking earlier at the beginning here, well, if you got capital assets, you're doing pretty well. Well, the tax rate on capital assets is lower than it is on ordinary income. And I've said from day one, I will never vote, this is a George H.W. Bush moment here, I will never vote to raise taxes on ordinary earned income. I don't care what the level is. If you're out there working day to day, you know, you're paying enough taxes. But in terms of capital gains, and I own stocks, I've, you know, been very fortunate in my life, but the tax rate on our stocks is lower than if a person's out there working. And Warren Buffett, who's, I think he's the richest person in America, if not, he's, you know, any given day, he's pretty close. He's the one who said that his secretary paid a higher tax rate than he did. He obviously makes more money. And there are ways to address that. Another thing that we should encourage in terms of corporate governance, and we forget this. How did this happen? Where in 1968, a corporate CEO made 20 times what a worker does, and today it's nearly 400. How did that happen? Well, they started changing the formula for compensation from earnings, corporate earnings, to the value of your stock. And so you have, you know, a lot of money coming in from overseas right now. This is the safest haven for investment. The value of the stock is going up, and it's not unusual in many of these firms today to see corporate CEOs making $100 million or more a year. In fact, I was just reading in Variety newspaper when I was in Thailand last week, where the CEO, I think, I don't want to misquote the, I'm going to leave it blank, of one of the studios out there made like $150 million last year, and the people in, even people in Hollywood are mad because they're only making $20 million. You know, but when you have that kind of disparity based on the value of a stock rather than the earnings of a company, I think that's something that's not particularly healthy. And on the other hand, you've got the people in your age group who are accumulating huge debt on student loans, and who are looking at a work environment where you can't predict. My oldest daughter works for the Disabled American Veterans. She loves her job. She's been over there for 5 years. But she's been 5 years over there as a contract worker. You know, she gets good hours. She gets paid by the hour, but she doesn't get health care, and she doesn't get a retirement. And I'm not picking on the DAV. That's the model. That's the model now, and it shouldn't be, really.
Let's get to some more questions right here in front with Y Squared.
Thank you, Mr. Senator. Earlier, you mentioned your opposition to the war in Iraq and the foresight of the potential consequences. On the other hand, we saw that since the Arab awakening, similar countries neighboring Iraq with a similar dictatorship with minority government embroiled in uprising and armed conflict along sectarian lines. Did the U.S. intervention accelerate the inevitable in Iraq? In other words, did we break it, and should we and can we fix it? Thank you.
I think I mentioned the... it's at some length the situation in Libya. You know, that's kind of a prototype for how I see the difficulties in operating in that region. That is the most complicated region in the world in terms of ethnic minorities, tribalism. That's one thing I was saying about Libya. If you go in there and take out Muammar Gaddafi, you better be able to replace it with something. The first rule of wing walking is, you know, make sure you have a good grasp on where you're going before you let go of where you are. And you can't get to the Tripoli airport right now. The Gaddafi's weapon systems, there was a study by the Kennedy School at Harvard about the number of weapon systems in Libya that were taken away from Libya and are being used all over the region. Those are the kinds of catastrophic consequences that can take place if you don't think these things through. And I assume when you're mentioning this other bordering country that's got different sectarian groups, you're probably talking about Syria, or notionally about Syria. You know, we've got this, there could be no greater example of the complexities of the region than what's going on in Syria. On the one hand, we were training up anti-Assad fighters to try to help overthrow Assad, the head of Syria. Then ISIS came up, and ISIS really basically is a Sunni outgrowth of Al-Qaeda, just more vicious, et cetera. It's attracting people. You never know on any given day how many people in that region are aligned with one of these groups versus the other. I mean, I know for a fact that, or from people who know that there are some of these people we trained as anti-Assad who are now working on the other side as well. And we are kind of aligned with Iran in Syria, or we're, you know, we are turning a blind eye. They kind of have the same objectives when it comes to these groups like ISIS. At the same time, we're warning that Iran is the great threat in the region, and that the eastern half of Iraq is now controlled by Iran. You could just see how complicated this all gets. So what the United States needs to do is to very carefully describe our national security interests, you know, very specifically our national security interests in the region, and not to be involved on the ground. I had a great lesson I learned a great lesson when I was a journalist in Beirut, 1983, when the Marines, the United States Marines were there. And let's recall, for those of you who don't remember, we didn't send in the Marines to occupy Beirut. We had the United States, the UK, Italy, and France, all four put in a peacekeeping force to separate the factions. The Israelis had come over and were battling the Palestinian Liberation Army in Beirut. We wanted to separate these factions and try to see some peace in Beirut. And it ended up being a total nightmare. You had like at least five different factions at each other on any given day. And I remember I was out on an outpost with a Marine unit one day, and there a firefight started between a Druze militia and a Lebanese, quote, Lebanese army position. And then the Marines got involved, and then one of the phalange groups got involved, and the Syrians came over a ridge line and started firing down into the thing. And this Marine turned around to me and said, "Sir, never get involved in a five-sided argument." No.
We'll go right here to Alex.
I want to come back a bit and talk about the issue of sexual assault in the United States military. If you were in the Senate today, or if you were the President of the United States today, how would you work to solve this issue? Would you support taking it out of the chain of command, as Senator Gillibrand proposes, or would you go a different way?
I think this issue has the military's full attention. I don't think there's any question about that. And my view has been that the approach that Claire McCaskill has taken is the best approach. I mean, unless there are egregious claims, once you start taking decisions out of the chain of command, it's kind of dangerous to the whole notion of the way the military works. So Claire McCaskill's been a lot of time working on this. I talked to her about it several times. She is a former prosecutor. She in Missouri. She as her feelings are every bit as strong as Senator Gillibrand's, and I just think her approach was a logical approach, looking at the issue the way it is right now.
Liz, there are a lot of hands over here, so we'll go right there.
Thank you, Senator Webb, for coming. So just going into your background a little bit, you've been married three times, and you have a mixed family. And when I say mixed, I mean you have children from multiple marriages. And this presents a different image of family than what we're used to seeing when we talk about front runners for the presidency or really any office. So I'm wondering, considering your family background, what are you bringing to the scene? Like, what are you bringing that's new in terms of family policy and as a father of this kind of family?
Well, I'm a member of the baby boom generation, and we were a generation that really ended up kind of pioneering the relationships between the sexes in a different way. And I would love to sit up here and say I got married when I was 22, and I'm still with the same person, but I'm not, and I'm with the person that I love. And I have kids, I take care of my kids, and I think that's the best approach anyone can take. I don't think there's any new approach that needs to be taken.
You, sir.
Senator, how you doing, sir?
Good. A little hot, but good.
You've been in worse, sir. Naval Academy graduate as well, sir. Thanks for getting me here on the GI Bill. Along those lines, there's been a lot of talk lately. I've seen, I think, the third brief in the last 5 years about military retirements. I was wondering about your thoughts about overhauling that system, a system that you weren't brought into with pretty serious service, but doing that before overhauling congressional or senatorial retirements prior to looking at the military.
I think it's a fair question. And by the way, I'm glad to see you're using the GI Bill. Make a 60-minute commercial for that. You know, before I even came to the Senate, I was saying that the people who served since 9/11, you keep calling them the next greatest generation. Well, how about giving them the same GI Bill that the greatest generation had? And I wrote that bill before I was sworn in. I wrote it between the end of the election and before I was sworn in. I was a former committee counsel on the Veterans Committee. And you know, people say you can't get things done. And in the United States Congress. That was not an easy lift. It's so logical when you look back on it, but it was not an easy lift. We were opposed by the Bush administration until the day that bill was signed. I still have the tally sheet on my wall in my writing office because John McCain and Lindsey Graham voted against this GI Bill. But we put together a bill, pay your tuition, buy your books, give you a monthly stipend, and you earned it. With respect to the whole military compensation issue in the retirement system, I was just reading a summary on the airplane of the recommendations from this latest commission report. And I think that the service that people give is often not fully understood by our country. When you step forward and say you're going to serve, you just basically handed your life over to the leadership of the United States government. They could send you wherever they want to send you. They're going to give you the military occupational specialty that they decide you want to have. You can't decide if you like your boss or not, if you want to leave your job, and all these things that you know from military service. And I was surprised at a number of the recommendations in this military commission. And I have to say, one of the most surprising moments I've had on this issue actually came about a year ago when some of the flag rank officers testified in the Armed Services Committee about reducing the benefits of what they call the early retirees, the 20-year retirees, saying that their benefits could be reduced until they reached a certain age. That flabbergasted me. You got a gunnery sergeant out there who maybe pulled 3 or 4 tours, gets out after 20 hard years, and they say, oh, well, that person, we can we can reduce their benefits until they hit 62. But a general officer to say that? I mean, forget about the members of Congress. If you're a four-star general, you make $232,000 a year just in your retirement. Plus, you're going to get on a board. You're going to be able to do these things. There's a rule number one. I mean, you're Navy, Marine Corps. Marine Corps, rule number one, Chesty Puller's rule. First you feed the privates, then you feed the sergeants, then if anything's left over, the officers eat. And that should be the maxim when it comes to stuff like this. First you take care of your people, then you take care of yourself.
Harry, I believe there's a hand up second to back row.
Hi, Senator. Would you be able to tell me a little bit about what you believe America's top grand strategy goals are? Should they be climate change? Should it be Ukraine? What are the top grand strategy issues that the U.S. is going to face over the next several years?
I think in terms of grand strategy, which also includes economic policy, we need to have a construct that communicates to our people here and to the rest of the world the principles on which we are engaging the rest of the world. Part of this is economic, but also a part of it is how we address the international terrorism issue. And the other part of it is where in the long term should we be putting our energies, you mentioned climate change, not that kind of energy, but our national energy in terms of assuring our growth and our continued interaction with the world. And for me, the place that we have shown the most neglect is East Asia. If you go from the Strait of Malacca up past through the South China Sea, you're hitting a huge percentage of the world's commerce every day, just along that one sea route, China, Japan, Korea, Vietnam, Philippines. I was just in Thailand. I was there at the invitation of their government. I don't know how many people follow East Asian politics. Thailand's in a historic crisis right now. They had a coup, although a coup in Thailand is different than a coup in Cuba. They're a different form of government, but the military took over the government. They have broad corruption that they have viewed in the system. They're trying to fix the system. They asked me to come in and sit down and talk with them because of the years I've been involved over there. And the most worrisome comment that I kept hearing over and over again was, this is the low point of our relations with the United States in history. Thailand has a 180-year treaty of friendship with the United States since Andrew Jackson's administration. And they're saying, where are you? We're looking at China. You know, China's here. And the United States has disappeared. That is from pretty much from the time I left the Senate. That part of the world has not been getting the attention that it deserves, other than in military terms, like with our relations with Vietnam and those sorts of things. So our crucial national strategic issue that we're not addressing is the way that we should be more involved in East Asia economically, in security guarantees, and showing up. Such a big part of it is just showing up. When I was in Senate, I used to make 3 trips a year. Every time we had an extended break in the Senate, I'd make a trip to East Asia, sit down with the heads of state, the foreign ministers, listen to them, show them that, you know, that we wanted to remain involved. That's where we really need to continue putting our energies.
We'll go right over here, Liz.
Thank you, Senator. Just now you mentioned China many times, and in your speech you also said that China was empowered by the Iraq war, waged by Bush administration.
Was empowered by?
By the Iraqi war. So my question is, as you know, and probably it's your expertise, that China has military build-up every year, over 10% or 12%. So, and also according to your own affiliation with Vietnam, so what would be your concrete strategy towards China? Or is it just anti-bashing China, you know, China-bashing strategy?
No, I think that the Chinese government unfortunately tends to view what we are attempting to do in that region simply as containment, or as you said, as China bashing. The reality is, if you look at East and Southeast Asia, that is, start with the Korean Peninsula, that is the only place in the world where the direct interests of China, Japan, and Russia intersect, historically. And whenever one country has become so powerful that it starts attempting to force its policies in on the region, you have wars, you have a volatile situation. And if you look at, you can look at our relations with China in 2 different ways. One is economically, we are kind of interlocked. You know, we need to work out the future relationship between the two countries. But militarily, we have, and in, on issues of sovereignty in areas like the South China Sea, China has become very aggressive over the last 20 years. And I have written about it for 20 years. The Senkaku Islands, between Taiwan and Japan, Okinawa, Japan. Actually, in my last debate when I was running for the Senate, we were able to ask each other one question. I asked Senator Allen, what do you think we ought to do about the Senkaku Islands? And there's like, you could see all the computer screens going on in the news, you know, news section up above the floor, you know, people Googling, what the hell is this Senkaku Islands? But it became a key flashpoint from April 2010 forward between Japan and China. There are a lot of people who believe that the Senkaku Islands really is an aggressive step for sovereignty issues in Okinawa. You look at all the way down into the South China Sea. Just in 2012, it's 2 years ago, not even 2 years ago, I'm sorry, no, not even 3 years ago, China created a new prefecture, an entirely new prefecture called Sansha. It takes in 2 million square kilometers all the way down toward the Strait of Malacca of land claims in the South China Sea. They are building military structures in the Paracels and in the Spratly Islands. And the United States, since World War II, has been the principal guarantor of stability in that part of the world. We have counterbalanced the historic tensions among China, Russia, and Japan to the benefit of the what I would call the second-tier countries. So for the future, we need to remain serious about Chinese military activities. We need to work on multilateral solutions. That is the key. That's what I have been talking about with the ASEAN countries, the countries of Southeast Asia. China will only deal with one country at a time. You can't solve some of these problems one country at a time, any more than you can solve the issues in the Mekong River Delta one country at a time, which is another issue we worked on. So we need to encourage China to come to the table for on multilateral solutions to a lot of these issues.
We are running close on time, so as is customary here, I know there are a lot of hands up, but we will give the last question to David Axelrod.
Oh, boy.
Way to make me popular with all the students here.
It's on you.
Senator, we're both former journalists, so in recognition of that, I'm going to ask two questions and pretend that they're related. The first is about money in politics. The forecasts are that the eventual nominees of the party could raise as much as $1.5 billion in this campaign and then have supporting PACs that have hundreds of millions of additional dollars. There are all these third parties active as well. And you referenced some of this in your remarks. As you contemplate your plans and being a notoriously poor fundraiser, which may redound to your credit, I don't know, as a public official, but being a notoriously poor fundraiser, how much does the burden of raising the money to run weigh on you in that decision? That's the first question and answer, and then I'll ask the unrelated related question.
What's your other question?
Okay. Well, tackle that one then.
Okay, it's your institute. So. It is the great intimidator running for office, and you know, I can remember when I first announced for the Senate, and I went into my first policy meeting when we had this group. For the Senate staff to put together. They gave me my schedule, and the first week it said 30 hours call time, 30 hours of picking up the phone, calling people, asking for money, 3 hours policy time. I said, I can't do that. I can't sit in front of a phone for 30 hours a week. I just can't do it. When you're seeing the numbers that we're seeing right now that you mentioned, I think one of the questions we have to ask is this really healthy for the country? Is it? I don't think it is. And I don't know how to get around this. I have some thoughts. I wrote a memo after I read the Citizens United case back in 12, and it seemed to me that the only arbiter that we might be able to find is the Federal Elections Commission. They were paralyzed by the nominations process and everything else. So somewhere, and there have been a couple cases that I've seen, somewhere the court system needs to start taking on the notion of what is independent and what is not in terms of an expenditure and the cooperation by candidates. And as far as me raising money, well, maybe weakness is a strength these days. I don't know. I mean, I can't go out and do that. So we have other avenues to try to get the issues out, and that's what we're doing at the moment.
So here's my other question. You were, I think, discreet in reference to Secretary Clinton earlier, but I do. You did mention the intervention in Libya as a catastrophic mistake, and in her retelling of that in her book, she claims credit for being a force behind making that decision. What does that portend for her foreign policy? And would this be a major difference between you should you run and she run for president?
Well, I think certainly it is a major policy distinction between what I was saying and what the administration was doing, and I was very vocal about it. We tried Senator Corker, who's now the chairman of the Foreign Relations Committee, and I tried to get this issue up for a debate on the Senate floor. The issue of unilateral intervention, the issue of a president having the authority to do this without coming to the Congress. And we were stonewalled, quite frankly, by the leadership. Neither party really wanted to discuss it. But it's certainly a different view of policy and how you should use presidential authority and the military.
And would you expect that would be a point of debate and discussion in the campaign were the two of you running?
Stay tuned.
Well, on that note, there's lots to stay tuned for.
Thank you very much.
Senator.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.
For many, many years, and as a defense executive and a committee counsel in the Congress, but I'd never run before. And it's an entirely different process when you actually run for a higher level position and start anticipating. You can say, all right, I'm a very bad fundraiser. Everybody here, I think, knows that. If you don't, I'll remind you. But you say, okay, I'm not going to go ask you for your money. You know, I'm independent. I have these views. And then somebody starts saying to you, well, you know what's going to happen about the second week of October? You know what you're going to see? You know how many of these things you're going to see coming at you? And that was before the Citizens United case. So I think what, at a minimum, what you're seeing in our political process is an intimidation of a lot of good people who would otherwise want to participate, who realize that they have to go out and raise this kind of money and potentially make the kind of compromises that makes it less of an incentive to come in and serve their country the way that they might. I have a good friend who will remain nameless, but he's a very, very successful business person. I know him from the Marine Corps. When I started talking to him 6 or 7 months ago about what it might take to run for the presidency, the very first thing he said to me was, I have never met anyone who was able to survive this whole process and come out on the other end able to speak his mind the way that he did before he entered it. There are just too many compromises that have to be made with the money that's in the process right now. I like to believe that that's not necessarily an absolute. I like to believe that with the right kind of help from the people who see where the problems are, you might be able to do it, not with the same kind of money, but truly, I think we are freezing out a lot of good minds and good leaders from the political process right now with the way that money has started dominating things that we do. And that being said, I think we're right about on schedule. I'll just start taking some questions. Yes. Oh, that's we're gonna go. You go ahead. I cut off the process, but since I called it, you go right ahead.
Thank you. Hi, Senator. Thank you so much for coming. You're one of my favorite politicians and authors simultaneously. I have a question for you. Should you run in 2016? I was thrilled to hear your announcement in November. A lot of the national discourse, especially in the Democratic Party, has to do with social issues. And while the issues that you've mentioned here are some of the most important to me, I think a lot of what dominates the conversation are things like women's issues and gay marriage. Your positions on which have been controversial in the Democratic Party, how do you plan to address those kinds of issues when and if you run?
Okay, thank you for the question. I've taken strong positions on a lot of issues over the years, but I think if you look at my voting record and otherwise in the Democratic Party, the time that I was in the Senate, I don't have any conflict with the Democratic Party at all on those issues. Here's my greater concern, and that is, when I decided to run for the Senate as a Democrat, and by the way, there are people who said, "What do you work for Ronald Reagan? How can you run as a Democrat?" You know, and I said, "Let's not forget, Ronald Reagan was once a Democrat, and not only but the Democrats elected Ronald Reagan twice, the Reagan Democrats." But when I decided to run as a Democrat, the reason that I did was because the Democratic Party traditionally, from its founding, has been the party that addresses the issues of well-being and opportunity for everyone. to give the working people in the country a voice in the corridors of power that otherwise they would not have. And when you look at these issues like economic fairness and criminal justice reform, these are issues that cut across gender, they cut across race, and yet too often they have been characterized as excluding white working people. Particularly in the border south for a lot of different reasons. And one of the things that, I've said again and again is that the Democratic Party needs to get back on message in terms of inclusiveness. We're a very complicated country demographically, even more complicated than we were when the civil rights movement did all those things, you know, 45 and 50 years ago. And we need to bring everyone forward so that people feel that they all have a shot. And the social issues that you mentioned are issues where I think there's been, unfortunately, a dividing line. If you look at the American South, look at the voting of working white people. And, you know, frankly, a lot of times even saying that phrase causes people to get nervous in our country anymore, and it should not. I remember when I'm gonna back up one second here when I say before I get into the election results. When I was running, we had a meeting of the candidates who were running in 06, the Senate candidates, up in Nantucket. It's the only time I've ever been to Nantucket. I will never go back to Nantucket. But we had this consultant group that came in, and they're talking about how do you run, you know, and they had this issue and that issue, and they said, okay, how do you get the white working male? And they had these support this, support this, support this. And I said, hey, you know, this isn't really that hard. They aren't aligning themselves with the Democratic Party because they don't think the Democratic Party wants them. And so on these social issues, rather than on their own economic well-being and the historical notion, you know, Harry Truman, Franklin Roosevelt, Andrew Jackson, this is where they should be. But instead, two-thirds of them vote Republican. You take a look at the poorest county in America, Clay County, Kentucky, in the Appalachian Mountains. And my dad's family came out of the Appalachian Mountains. 94% white. 40% poverty. They vote two-thirds for Mitch McConnell when he runs for re-election. And they vote on these social issues. The social wars are, I'm not going to say they're over, but I think the country is now so much better off on these issues than it was years ago that this is a real opportunity for the Democratic Party to bring these people back in an inclusive way.
Senator, if you just want to grab a seat. I'm Matt Jaffe. I'm the IOP.
Sorry for jumping you.
No worries. I know there are a lot of questions tonight, so hopefully we'll get to as many of them as possible. I'm Matt Jaffe. I'm the IOP's communications director, and I know that there are a lot of questions out there, so we'll get back to the Q&A in just a second, and as always, we'll start with student questions. First, I just had a quick question for you. You know, you are the first well-known Democrat to launch an exploratory committee. You're heading, I believe, to Iowa for 4 days later this week, South Carolina later this month. I think New Hampshire next month. So I think one of the questions on everybody's minds is, are you planning to run for president?
Well, we're taking it a day at a time. And I think that's realistically the best way for us or other people who might be running. But actually what... going back to your question. You know, when I left the Senate... I decided I would take a year and do no interviews at all, no op-eds. I used to write a lot of op-eds for New York Times and Wall Street Journal both, and kind of get my philosophical independence back, away from the caucus mentality and those sorts of things. And when I started getting out again last May, I just started getting a ton of emails and communications from people. I started on an NPR show, and you know, it's one of these, you know, how the media questions go. The question was, would you consider running for vice president? I said, no, you do not want me as your vice president. And they said, well, how about president? And I said, I don't know. What I know is this, that we are back in the discussion again after it had been a year and 4 months by then. We're back in the discussion. We're back in the debate. I know the issues that I care about. We're going to put them out there. And I just started getting a ton of emails. Some people saying, Republicans, independence and what I would call the Truman Roosevelt Democrats, just hundreds of emails coming in saying, please consider running. So, you know, we've been around talking to people, listening to people, which is the only way, you know, someone who has been out of office like I have, it's the only way to really test the water. So we're going into Iowa. I'm going to spend 4 days in Iowa starting tomorrow. And as you said, we're going to be in New Hampshire, and we'll just see.
One of the candidates who looks like she's set to jump into the race, of course, is Hillary Clinton. And recent polls have shown her up around 60%. But Al Hunt, a columnist for Bloomberg, recently wrote a story that said why Jim Webb could be Hillary Clinton's worst nightmare. Do you think, I won't ask you if you think you might be her worst nightmare, but do you think that Hillary Clinton is beatable in 2016?
I think early poll numbers can always be tricky. As I recall, I think in 92, Bill Clinton was at about 3% early in 92. So the poll numbers in and of themselves, they're almost more name identification at this point. But other than that, you know, I respect Hillary Clinton's service, served with her in the Senate. And I don't think I should be commenting on me running against her. She's got a good record.
I want to ask you a quick question about your time in the Senate. You were elected in 2006, and you beat George Allen in Virginia. In that race, you only jumped in, I believe it was 9 months before Election Day. You had very little money, very little staff, and I think a lot of people looked at early polls and kind of thought that they did not bode well for you. And of course, you ended up winning that race.
There may be a pattern here, by the way.
Yeah.
You can see this in the manner in which we address legitimate national security interests in the Middle East. But the way that we did them was not healthy for the region or for the national security of our country. I was the first person, I believe, to have warned about the war in Iraq, the consequences of the war in Iraq, 5 months before the invasion of Iraq. I wrote a piece in the Washington Post basically saying, if we invade Iraq, this is going to be a strategic blunder. It's going to empower not only Iran, but China. And if you can take a look at what's happened in East Asia since then, that is actually happening. And it's going to break the country apart in terms of sectarian violence. The other thing that I said in the piece was that there is no exit strategy because they don't intend to leave. We have suffered the consequences of that in terms of trillions of dollars of expenditures. Our position in the region from the invasion of Iraq and from other policies has destabilized a lot of the region. And again, in ecumenical fairness here, I have to say I believe the way in which this present administration handled the Arab Spring has had strong negative consequences for our position in the region. I was a vocal opponent of the manner in which the administration went into Libya. If you look at the action in Libya in historical terms, sure, Gaddafi was a bad guy. We understand that. But we had no treaties in place. We had no Americans at risk. We were not under any threat of attack. If you have a situation like that, you need to come to the United States Congress, if you're the president, before you use military force. The doctrine that was announced when we went into Libya was basically a humanitarian assistance doctrine, a humanitarian intervention doctrine, or in the military they call it R2P, responsibility to protect. And the way that that policy has been put into place, it means potentially that a president on his own initiative, without coming, or her initiative, without coming to the Congress, can decide to use military force anywhere. Under the broad terms of humanitarian intervention, you could decide that how many Irish people with Irish ancestry are here. I may be treading something here, but I mean, if you have the IRA going at it with the Ulster Protestants, the president under this doctrine could decide, all right, we're going to put military forces in. It's a very dangerous doctrine. In terms of issues of terrorism and the Middle East, I think we are well behind where we could have been if we had taken different decisions in that part of the world. I have spent a great deal of my life working in and out of Asia, particularly Southeast Asia, as a journalist, as a military person, as a government official, as a writer, as a novelist. I've spent a good bit of time in that region. And I have to say, one of the things I'm proudest of during the time that we were in the Senate was that we began what was became called the pivot to Asia when the Obama administration came into authority. We began that program, or the strengthening of our relationships in East Asia, 2 years before President Obama was elected. I fought to get a seat on the Foreign Relations Committee. I brought people from my staff in and I said, we must, for our strategic, economic, cultural, and other interests, we must reinvigorate our relation with Japan, South Korea, Vietnam, Singapore, Thailand, and we must change the formula in what was then called Burma, which now I think we're finally using the term Myanmar. We worked very hard to create the new relationship in Myanmar, in Burma. I had visited Burma as a private citizen before I was elected. I had begun talking about the better approach in that country, reducing the sanctions, encouraging it to move toward democracy. I'd seen the model work in Vietnam after the end of the Vietnam War, after we had had sanctions against the Vietnamese government from 1975 to 1994, which, by the way, I supported for a very long time because of the conditions of the Arvin soldiers and families who had been with us and who were being maltreated by the communists. But we changed the formula in Vietnam. It has made a remarkable difference in the country. We're still waiting for democracy in Vietnam. We're still waiting for opposition parties. But removing the sanctions, getting people in to trade and to show how the outside world looks at different issues has had a major impact. We did the same thing in Burma. It took me 7 months from our office to negotiate a visit to Burma in 2009. And I became the first American leader to visit that country. We started opening up the relations, and the Burmese now are moving much, much more closely to an open democracy. They're not there yet, but they're certainly a long way away from where they were in 2009 when we began this process. We spent a lot of time talking about issues of social justice, like the criminal justice reform issue. If you look at the future of the country, these are the kinds of things that we're still going to focus on. I want to spend just a couple minutes talking about an issue facing our country, our leadership, and our political system that troubles me greatly, and I think that we need to find a better way forward on. And that is what a lot of people are calling the corruption of our political system due to the way that campaign finance has changed. I get around the country a lot, different, not only geographically, but I've got a lot of friends who do different things. And one thing I hear over and over again is how frustrated people in this country have become with the political leadership in both parties. We call it incumbent fatigue. They don't see the answers coming out of the political system right now. And if you look at the larger political system, before we look at leadership per se, you can see such a dramatic difference just since the Citizens United case in 2012. For those of you who aren't familiar with the Supreme Court case, it basically said, and terms of the First Amendment that you cannot stop any person, any corporation, any organization from spending as much money as they want to spend in order to exercise their First Amendment rights when it comes to political discussion. What we're seeing here is a classic confrontation between law and the First Amendment, both areas of which we hold sacrosanct in our country. The First Amendment says you can't stop me from expressing my views. The legal side says you can only spend so much money on a political campaign. I'll give you a good example. For our presidential exploratory committee right now, the maximum anybody can give is $2,700. But that same person can walk across the street, open up a super PAC or a 501c nonprofit and spend $200 million if they want. And there are people who are spending, you know, in the millions of dollars and organizations, millions of dollars in a super PAC or a so-called nonprofit. And a lot of times we don't even know who these people are. I've read this case, the Citizens United case. I understand Justice Kennedy's rationale when he says that the First Amendment is sacrosanct. What they said in this case, though, was that is for independent expression. In other words, you're not supposed to be communicating with a candidate when you do this. If you communicate with the candidate, well, then it's $2,700. But our political process has made a mockery of this decision. We're looking, you know, in terms of presidential runs, we're looking at the potential of people raising not just hundreds of millions of dollars, but close to $1 billion. Now, where's that money coming from? And what are the expectations when tons of money is coming in to support one candidate or another? And is this really independent expenditure separate from a candidate? We've seen Jeb Bush, not to pick on him, but he's been in the paper in the last week or so on this. He's got two super PACs. Since he's not officially a candidate, he's able to go sit down with this supposedly independent organization and discuss strategies with them. I wouldn't say that is what the Supreme Court intended when this legislation or when this decision came down. And how does that affect individuals who want to participate or are participating in the electoral process? Here's the reality. You know you got to raise a lot of money, and if you don't raise a lot of money, you're going to have a lot of stuff coming at you through the media and through other manners. You know, when I ran for the Senate, I had been involved in the political process as a commentator.
Evening, everybody. The Institute of Politics is predicated on the notion that politics is a worthy pursuit and that public service is an honorable way to devote one's life. And so it's an honor to bring Senator Jim Webb here tonight because he's devoted so much of his life to service in Vietnam, combat service as a leader of the military later under the Reagan administration, service as a United States senator. And in all of those pursuits, the thing that I think would be said of him is that he always put the public interest ahead of party, and that he took public service seriously as a means of bettering our country, advancing America and its values. And so it is, it's a great honor to welcome here tonight. I'm not going to go through his full history because we have a student, as we always do, here to introduce him, and I'm going to introduce that student if I can find my glasses. Brian Schwartz is a first year at the University of Chicago who hails from Eastern Long Island. He is a prospective chemistry and molecular engineering double major. show off. When not working on his academics, he is the vice president and director of athletics for the Maroons Veterans Alliance, a new organization on the University of Chicago campus working to help veterans get the medical support and career advocacy needed to return into the workforce. With the MVA, he ran the first 3-on-3 basketball tournament that raised funds for the Intrepid Fallen Heroes Fund and is planning a spring tennis tournament for the same charity. So all of you tennis players here, please see Brian after this program. Brian.
Thank you, Professor Axelrod. It is my pleasure and honor to introduce Senator Jim Webb here to the University of Chicago. So coming from a military family, Senator Webb would follow in his father's footsteps of entering the U.S. Armed Forces, becoming a part of the Marine Corps and Navy. Mr. Webb graduated from the Naval Academy in 1968, receiving a special commendation for his leadership contributions. He served as a rifle platoon and company commander in Vietnam. Mr. Webb served as counsel to the House Committee on Veterans Affairs from 1977 to 1981. In 1984, he was appointed Assistant Secretary of Defense for Reserve Affairs, the first person to hold this position, and in 1987 was appointed to the Secretary of the Navy. While in the Senate, Mr. Webb served on the Foreign Relations, Armed Services, Veterans Affairs, and the Joint Economic Committees. On his first day in office, he wrote and guided to passage the post-9/11 GI Bill, the most significant veterans legislation since World War II, and co-authored legislation which exposed $60 billion of waste, fraud, and abuse in Iraq and Afghanistan wartime support contracts. In addition to his public service, Mr. Webb has enjoyed a varied career as a journalist. He received an Emmy Award for his PBS coverage of the U.S. Marines in Beirut in 1983. Due to his heroism in the military, he was awarded the Navy Cross, the Silver Star Medal, 2 Bronze Star Medals, and 2 Purple Hearts. His citation for the Navy Cross says, "By his courage, aggressive leadership, and selfless devotion to duty, First Lieutenant Webb upheld the highest traditions of the Marine Corps and of the United States Naval Service." Thank you, Senator, for speaking at our event today. It is an honor to have you at the University of Chicago Institute of Politics. Please join me in giving a warm welcome to Senator Jim Webb. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Brian. I don't know what a molecular engineer does. I have to say, I'm a little in awe. When I went to the Naval Academy, we had a mandatory engineering program, which I kind of suffered through, and used to do things like carve in our desk, "Entropy is alive and living in Argentina." I was one of, I guess, 3 people in the United States Senate with an engineering degree, but trust me, you do not want me as your engineer. And David, thank you very much for this invitation, and it's an honor to be here with David. The service that he has given to our country and many different political leaders has made a mark that's made him one of the top, very top tier of political analysts and commentators in the country, and also for your leadership in establishing this Institute of Politics. I was a fellow at the Harvard Institute of Politics in 1992. I think this is a very similar program and not a great deal of enthusiasm when I was at the Harvard program. So I appreciate all of you coming tonight. We have, I guess, about 1 hour to the minute here. And I will warn you at the beginning, I just got off a plane from Bangkok 2 days ago, and my time zones are a little conflicted. I'll tell you a little bit more about the reason for that earlier, but I'll do my best to concentrate and answer your questions during the Q&A, and I look forward very much to the Q&A. I've spent just about half of my professional life in public service and half in the private sector as a sole proprietor and principally as a writer. It's a career that does not naturally align, but I believe it's really been useful in terms of looking at what's going on in our country from different perspectives than I would have been able to have if I had simply stayed in the political environment throughout my professional career. When I ran for the Senate, we focused on three main issues, and I think they're still the principal issues as we look forward to where the country needs to be fixed. The first was to address issues of economic fairness and social justice. And I was saying in 06 that we had a breaking apart in this country, not from the top to the bottom, and the John Edwards I know was running and was talking about the two Americas, but that we're moving into basically what could be called three Americas. We are a country that is rightly dedicated to helping people who have become unable to help themselves or who need a hand when times are bad. We've got a good safety net in this country, I think, for people who have fallen by the wayside and need some sort of government assistance. At the top, we've seen an elite move further and further away from the rest of the country. And this has only become worse over the past 7 or 8 years, not better. But we're seeing a lot of people start talking about this. I was very privileged to give the State of the Union response to President Bush's State of the Union address in 07, and people wanted me to talk about the war in Iraq, and I did. But the first thing I talked about was the need for us to reinvigorate opportunity for the entire country. We want everyone to be able to believe in the American dream. When I graduated from the Naval Academy, the average corporate executive in this country made 20 times what the average worker made. Today, that number is upwards of 300. It depends on how you calibrate it, but it's probably closer to 400 times what the average worker in this country makes. At the same time, the model of the American workforce is changing for our younger generation, just as the demographics are changing. With the loss of the manufacturing sector jobs that we've seen over the past 20 years and the evolution of service economies and contractual work, it's very difficult for younger people and a lot of people who are not younger people to have the type of occupation and work where they get health care benefits as a part of their employment. And they have retirement benefits as a part of their program. I mean, they can look forward to a career in a particular career field. These things are rapidly changing as our economy also changes. So we're looking at a situation in this country, even with the recuperation from the Great Recession, 08, 09, where if you have an education from a place like the University of Chicago, if you have capital assets, you're probably doing pretty well. For instance, if you look at the stock market, I don't know what the numbers are today, but when the stock market bottomed out in April of 09, it was just a little bit above 6,000. It's now almost tripled. In fact, it was above 18,000 last month. I don't know where it is at the exact moment. So if you have stocks, if you're able to participate in the capital side of our economy, you're probably doing pretty well. And if you don't, you're probably not doing very well. If you look at real wages, they have actually dropped since the 09 numbers started going up. Loans for small businesses have gone down as the economy writ large has gone up. These are challenges, and they are challenges for our leadership. The second issue that we focused on when I was running, when I was in the Senate, was the need for us to reorient our national security policy around the world. We really have not had a clear strategic doctrine since the end of the Cold War, I would say, particularly since about 1993, but since the fall of the Berlin Wall, the demise of the Soviet Union. We have been playing ad hoc when it comes to our foreign policy. Very carefully describe our national security interests, very specifically our national security in the region, and not to be involved on the ground. I had a great lesson, I learned a great lesson when I was a journalist in Beirut. 1983, when the United States Marines were there. And let's recall, for those of you who don't remember, we didn't send in the Marines to occupy Beirut. We had the United States, the UK, Italy, and France, all four put in a peacekeeping force to separate the factions. The Israelis had come over and were battling the Palestinian Liberation Army in Beirut. We wanted to separate these factions and try to see some peace in Beirut. And it ended up being a total nightmare. You had like at least five different factions at each other on any given day. And I remember I was out on an outpost with a Marine unit one day, and there a firefight started between a Druze militia and a Lebanese, quote, Lebanese army position. And then the Marines got involved, and then one of the phalange groups got involved, and the Syrians came over a ridge line and started firing down into the thing. And this Marine turned around to me and said, "Sir, never get involved in a five-sided argument." You know?
We'll go right here to Alex.
Sexual assault in the United States military. If you were in the Senate today, or if you were the President of the United States today, how would you work to solve this issue? Would you support taking it out of the chain of command, as Senator Gillibrand proposes, or would you go a different way?
I think this issue has the military's full attention. I don't think there's any question about that. And my view has been that the approach that Claire McCaskill has taken is the best approach. I mean, if you once you start, unless there are egregious claims, once you start taking decisions out of the chain of command, it's kind of dangerous to the whole notion of the way the military works. So Claire McCaskill's spent a lot of time working on this. I talked to her about it several times. She is a former prosecutor. She in Missouri. As her feelings are every bit as strong as Senator Gillibrand's, and I just think her approach was a logical approach, looking at the issue the way it is right now.
Liz, there are a lot of hands over here, so we'll go right there.
Thank you, Senator Webb, for coming. So just going into your background a little bit, you've been married 3 times, and you have a mixed family. And when I say mixed, I mean you have children from multiple marriages. And this presents a different image of family than what we're used to seeing when we talk about front runners for the presidency or really any office. So I'm wondering, considering your family background, what are you bringing to the scene? Like, what are you bringing that's new in terms of family policy and as a father of this kind of family?
Well, I'm a member of the baby boom generation, and we were a generation that really ended up kind of pioneering the relationships between the sexes in a different way. And I would love to sit up here and say I got married when I was 22 and I'm still with the same person, but I'm not. And I'm with the person that I love. And I have kids, I take care of my kids, and I think that's the best approach anyone can take. I don't think there's any new approach that needs to be taken.
You, sir.
Senator, how you doing, sir?
Good. A little hot, but good.
You've been in worse, sir. Naval Academy graduate as well, sir. Thanks for getting me here on the GI Bill. Along those lines, there's been a lot of talk lately. I've seen, I think, the third brief in the last 5 years about military retirements. I was wondering about your thoughts about overhauling that system, a system that you weren't brought into with pretty serious service, but doing that before overhauling congressional or senatorial retirements prior to looking at the military.
I think it's a fair question. And by the way, I'm glad to see you're using the GI Bill. Make a 60-minute commercial for that. You know, before I even came to the Senate, I was saying that the people who served since 9/11, you keep calling them the next greatest generation. Well, how about giving them the same GI Bill that the greatest generation had? And I wrote that bill before I was sworn in. I wrote it between the end of the election and before I was sworn in. I was a former committee counsel on the Veterans Committee. And people say you can't get things done in the United States Congress. That was not an easy lift. It's so logical when you look back on it, but it was not an easy lift. We were opposed by the Bush administration until the day that bill was signed. I still have the tally sheet on my wall in my writing office because John McCain and Lindsey Graham voted against this GI Bill. But We put together a bill, pay your tuition, buy your books, give you a monthly stipend, and you earned it. With respect to the whole military compensation issue and the retirement system, I was just reading a summary on the airplane of the recommendations from this latest commission report. And I think that the service that people give is often not fully understood by our country. When you step forward and say you're going to serve, you just basically handed your life over to the leadership of the United States government. They can send you wherever you want. They want to send you. They're going to give you the military occupational specialty that they decide that you want to have. You can't decide if you like your boss or not, if you want to leave your job, and all these things that you know from military service. And I was surprised at a number of the recommendations in this military commission. And I have to say, one of the most surprising moments I've had on this issue actually came about a year ago when some of the flag rank officers testified in the Armed Services Committee about reducing the benefits of what they call the early retirees, the 20-year retirees, saying that their benefits could be reduced until they reached a certain age. That flabbergasted me. You got a gunnery sergeant out there who maybe pulled 3 or 4 tours, gets out after 20 hard years, and they say, oh, well, that person, we can reduce their benefits until they hit 62. But a general officer to say that? I mean, forget about the members of Congress. If you're a four-star general, you make $232,000 a year just in your retirement. Plus, you're going to get on a board. You're going to be able to do these things. There's a rule number one. I mean, you're Navy, Marine Corps. Okay. In Marine Corps, rule number one, you know, Chesty Puller's rule. First you feed the privates. Then you feed the sergeants. Then if anything's left over, the officers eat. And that should be the maxim when it comes to stuff like this. First you take care of your people. Then you take care of yourself.
Harry, I believe there's a hand up second to back row.
Hi, Senator. Would you be able to tell me a little bit about what you believe America's top grand strategy goals are? Should they be climate change? Should it be Ukraine? What are the top grand strategy issues that the U.S. is going to face over the next several years?
I think in terms of grand strategy, which also includes economic policy, we need to have a construct that communicates to our people here and to the rest of the world the principles on which we are engaging the rest of the world. Part of this is economic, but also a part of it is how we address the international terrorism issue. And the other part of it is where in the long term should we be putting our energies, you mentioned climate change, not that kind of energy, but our national energy in terms of assuring our growth and our continued interaction with the world. And for me, the place that we have shown the most neglect is East Asia. If you go from the Strait of Malacca up past through the South China Sea, you're hitting a huge percentage of the world's commerce every day just along that one sea route: China, Japan, Korea, Vietnam, Philippines. I was just in Thailand. I was there at the invitation of their government. I don't know how many people follow East Asian politics. Thailand's in a historic crisis right now. They had a coup, although a coup in Thailand is different than a coup in Cuba. They're a different form of government, but the military took over the government. They have broad corruption that they have viewed in the system. They're trying to fix the system. They asked me to come in and sit down and talk with them because of the years I've been involved over there. And the most worrisome comment that I kept hearing over and over again was, this is the low point of our relations with the United States in history. Thailand has a 180-year treaty of friendship with the United States since Andrew Jackson's administration. And they're saying, where are you? We're looking at China. You know, China's here. And the United States has disappeared. That is from pretty much from the time I left the Senate. That part of the world is not been getting the attention that it deserves, other than in military terms, like with our relations with Vietnam and those sorts of things. So our crucial national strategic issue that we're not addressing is the way that...
You know, then you go on and you serve only one term in the Senate and you decide to leave. What was it about that term in the Senate, those 6 years in Washington on the Hill, that made you decide, I want to move on?
Well, I think people probably would understand that if they looked in the context of my professional career. 6 years is a term and a half of the presidency. It's not a short period of time. They say only one term. But I've spent four different periods in my life in public service. First in the Marine Corps, then as a committee counsel for 4 years in the House. Used to put 25 bills a year through the House floor. Then 5 years in the Pentagon, one as a Marine, and then four as a defense executive, and then in the Senate. And each time, I've taken a step back and done journalism, done these other things. So it wasn't simply one term and I'm out. Mm-hmm. Now the election itself, we announced for the Senate 9 months to the day before the election, had no money, no campaign staff, but I did a lot of thinking beforehand. I mean, I like to think and then act, not act and then think. And we were 33 points behind on a good day. And I went out, I had a contested primary, and that was the first time I'd actually put myself before a vote of anyone, but it was a Democratic Party, established Democratic Party, person who was able to self-fund. Went out three meetings a night, got in an old Jeep, drove from place to place, got my... one of my radio operators from Vietnam, this guy Mac McGarvey, who'd gotten his arm blown off, got a tattoo on the stump, said cut on dotted line. I asked a question in there, anybody here been to Nashville before? Nashville, Tennessee? Yeah, Mac was the night manager at Tootsie's Orchid Lounge in Nashville. And I said, Mac, I need somebody that I can trust 24 hours a day. He quit his job, moved into my basement for a year, and became our driver. And Mac and I, we went out, three meetings a night. The first question I would get, this was a Democratic primary, first question I would get was, again, why should we vote for you when you work for Ronald Reagan? I already answered that. And then the second questions were usually about ideas and issues, the things we were talking about. We won the primary with a very strong vote. You could say we only won by 10,000, or you can say we came up from our 33-point deficit. I choose to say we came up from our 33-point deficit.
We will now start taking some more audience questions. So we'll start with students. So students, please raise your hands. We'll start right back there. Harry, right in the back, the gentleman in the blue shirt.
Hi, Senator. At the beginning of your speech, you talked about the ways in which the economy has fundamentally changed and what that means for the middle class and opportunity. Do you see that change as something that is fundamental and sort of something we must adapt to, or something that the government could work to correct?
I believe there are ways for us to address this issue. The first thing we need to remember is the most important facet of our economy is to keep growing it. You know, we need a strong economy. We are at a position now where I think even in the manufacturing sector, there are a number of companies who would want to come back here if the incentives were there. I mean, when you look at the cost of shipping and these sorts of things, particularly in Asia. The second thing I think we can look at is how the tax code protect a lot of the income that is received from, particularly from corporate executives and these sorts of things, where you've got this. First of all, here's a quick model of something we could be looking at. We have a very high corporate income tax rate, but there are a lot of loopholes in there. And I think we could lower the corporate income tax rate, remove the loopholes, incentivize a lot of corporations that are holding money overseas to bring money back in and do a better job with the strength of our economy. Southside Virginia is a good example of what's happened countrywide. You know, Southside Virginia used to have a large manufacturing sector, furniture, textiles, those sorts of things. It's all gone. And the workforce down there doesn't have the types of jobs that will hold them even in that part of Virginia. But you can do that. And then on the individual side, we've got this, I think, odd situation. Remember when I was talking earlier at the beginning here, well, if you got capital assets, you're doing pretty well. Well, the tax rate on capital assets is lower than it is on ordinary income. And I've said from day one, I will never vote, this is a George H.W. Bush moment here, I will never vote to raise taxes on ordinary earned income. I don't care what the level is. If you're out there working day to day, you know, you're paying enough taxes. But in terms of capital gains, and I own stocks. I've, you know, been very fortunate in my life. But the tax rate on our stocks is lower than if a person's out there working. And Warren Buffett, who's, I think he's the richest person in America, if not, he's, you know, any given day, he's pretty close. He's the one who said that his secretary paid a higher tax rate than he did. He obviously makes more money. And there are ways to address that. Another thing that we should encourage in terms of corporate governance, and we forget this. How did this happen? Where in 1968, a corporate CEO made 20 times what a worker does, and today it's nearly 400. How did that happen? Well, they started changing the formula for compensation from earnings, corporate earnings, to the value of your stock. And so you have, you know, a lot of money coming in from overseas right now. This is the safest haven for investment. The value of the stock is going up, and it's not unusual in many of these firms today to see corporate CEOs making $100 million or more a year. In fact, I was just reading in Variety newspaper when I was in Thailand last week where the CEO, I think, I don't want to misquote I'm going to leave it blank, of one of the studios out there made like $150 billion last year, and the people in, even people in Hollywood are mad because they're only making $20 million, you know. But when you have that kind of disparity based on the value of a stock rather than the earnings of a company, I think that's something that's not particularly healthy. And on the other hand, you've got the people in your age group who are accumulating huge debt on student loans and who are looking at a work environment where you can't predict. My oldest daughter works for the Disabled American Veterans. She loves her job. She's been over there for 5 years. But she's been 5 years over there as a contract worker. You know, she gets good hours, she gets paid by the hour, but she doesn't get health care, and she doesn't get a retirement. And I'm not picking on the DAV. That's the model. That's the model now, and it shouldn't be, really.
Let's get to some more questions right here in front with Y Squared.
Thank you, Mr. Senator. Earlier you mentioned your opposition to the war in Iraq and the foresight of the potential consequences. On the other hand, we saw that since the Arab Awakening, similar countries neighboring Iraq with a similar dictatorship with minority government embroiled in uprising and armed conflict along sectarian lines. Did the U.S. intervention accelerate the inevitable in Iraq? In other words, did we break it, and should we and can we fix it? Thank you.
I think I mentioned the... it's at some length the situation in Libya. You know, that's kind of a prototype for how I see the difficulties in operating in that region. That is the most complicated region in the world in terms of ethnic minorities, tribalism. That's one thing I was saying about Libya. If you go in there and take out Muammar Gaddafi, you better be able to replace it with something. The first rule of wing walking is, you know, make sure you have a good grasp on where you're going before you let go of where you are. And you can't get to the Tripoli airport right now. the Qaddafi's weapon systems, there was a study by the Kennedy School at Harvard about the number of weapon systems in Libya that were taken away from Libya and are being used all over the region. Those are the kinds of catastrophic consequences that can take place if you don't think these things through. And I assume when you're mentioning this other bordering country that's got different sectarian groups, you're probably talking about Syria, or notionally about Syria. You know, we've got this, there could be no greater example of the complexities of the region than what's going on in Syria. On the one hand, we were training up anti-Assad fighters to try to help overthrow Assad, the head of Syria. Then ISIS came up. And ISIS really basically is a Sunni outgrowth of Al-Qaeda, just more vicious, et cetera. It's attracting people. You never know on any given day how many people in that region are aligned with one of these groups versus the other. I mean, I know for a fact that, or from people who know that there are some of these people we trained as anti-Assad who are now working on the other side as well. And we are kind of aligned with Iran in Syria, we are turning a blind eye. They kind of have the same objectives when it comes to these groups like ISIS. At the same time, we're warning that Iran is the great threat in the region, and that the eastern half of Iraq is now controlled by Iran. You could just see how complicated this all gets. So what the United States needs to do is to very